Well, praise the Lord. This is the Holy Ghost Forum. We've been doing these now since October of 2015. And we're going to continue on here through the year. Now, we're going to take a couple of months break for the summer, but we'll be back with you in the fall. But we're going to just share about the Holy Ghost, share about the move of the Spirit, share about what God wants to do in a local church service. And these are friends of mine. To my far right here is Pastor Gary Rutter. And he pastors Blood-Bought Church in Murraysville, Pennsylvania.
Amen.
And right next to him is
Associate Pastor
Rob Lero. And we actually all three went to the same Bible school. All five of us went to the same Bible school.
Amen.
In Oklahoma. So, I'm Gary Bailey, and we're hosting the forum, and we're looking to have a good time here. And to my immediate left is Pastor Mark Moore, and he just took a charge in West Virginia.
Wheeling, West Virginia. Mm-hmm.
And so we're excited to hear from him this evening. And right next to him, to my far left, is Marlene Levin, and she pastors a church along with her husband in Delmont, Pennsylvania, Victory Word of Faith Church. Yeah, is that Victory First?
International Word of Faith Church.
Victory International
no
Word
Victory.
Of
Faith. That was close.
Victory.
But we do have it.
Amen. Amen. So praise the Lord. We're going to just share back and forth, and as before, ladies and gentlemen, we're just feel free to break in at any time to share what's on your heart. But what we'd like to do here to begin with, now we don't always do this, but let's just praise the Lord just a few moments and worship Him and let him know he has first place in this forum. Mm-hmm. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time together. We just worship you and praise you. We magnify the name of Jesus. We want to thank you, Lord, for doing as you please, having your way with us, ministering to the people that are watching this video.
Thank you, Jesus.
Lord, guide our steps, direct us as we speak forth your word, as we're sensitive to the Holy Spirit. Just do as you please. Holy Spirit, we welcome you to move in our midst, to have your way with us.
Thank you.
Lord, we praise you and we worship you. We magnify you, Father. We magnify you, Father. We magnify you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. We praise and worship the Lamb of God. We praise and worship the Lamb of God. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. 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 Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. One reason we even have this forum, that this forum exists, is to stir up and focus in on the move of the Spirit in the local church. Mm-hmm. Now, it's not the only thing that happens in a church service, but it's a very important aspect of a church service to allow the Holy Spirit to take charge and to lead the way in a church service. There's certain things that have to be accomplished in any gathering of people. You know, there's a meet and greet and kind of just fellowshipping one with another a little bit, and there's natural things to be taken care of. You know, if you're receiving an offering, there has to be time taken for the offering. If you're having worship, there's got to be time for worship in a church service. If the word is being preached, and it ought to be being preached in most gatherings where we'd gather together to receive the word, If the word is being preached, there has to be time for that. Even time for reading. Sometimes in some churches, they'll take time to read the scripture, which I'm a great believer in that. Just take time to read the Bible in church. Just to show that, hey, we honor His Word and put the Word first in our life. But what we want to zero in here, and what we want to talk about here today, is making room for the Holy Spirit in a church service, making room for the move of the Spirit. And I would say this, not just having a blank slate, but knowing what to do and how to cooperate and move along with the Holy Spirit in a church service. You may or may not have Bibles with you, but I want to read a scripture from 1 Corinthians chapter 14, and looking at verse 26, if I can get here quickly, but let's see here. 1 Corinthians and chapter 14 and beginning at verse 26. Now, Paul has already spent much time talking about the gift of tongues and prophecy and interpretation of tongues. He tells us the purpose of these in a service. You know, the gift of tongues is a great tool and weapon in our arsenal for worship and giving thanks, to speak mysteries to the Lord. The gift of prophecy, the simple gift, edifies, exhorts, and comforts. And he tells us very plainly, very clearly, that the gift of prophecy will bring edification to a church service. And he goes into great detail in the first half of chapter 14, talking about the gift of tongues, how when it is interpreted. In verse 6, he tells us that the gift of tongues will bring revelation, knowledge, prophecy, or doctrine into a church service. That's pretty important, because now we see that the gift of tongues in conjunction with interpretation of tongues can be prophecy, and then much more than prophecy. You know, I've had this comment made to me from time to time. I say, well, why even bother with the gift of tongues? Why not just cut to the chase and prophesy? You know, just, I would say this, that when we give place and make room for the gift of tongues in a church service, we begin to emphasize the Holy Spirit, because He is the voice of, tongues is His expression in the church. Go ahead, Pastor Gary.
Isola. Eshamborate etelaborotum in gende co ban yet alaborota salara co yende shibolaboruse cantiatosa.
For surely I want to communicate, and surely I want to make myself known. Even when you gather together, it's my will to speak to you. It's my will to communicate with you and to let you know what my purpose and will is for you that day. So the Holy Spirit wants to communicate to us, and when we make room, you know, Paul makes a big deal. It's just almost beyond me. How we can have a very clear teaching in Scripture in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, and then the majority of churches just totally ignore it. Or, in fact, do the opposite. I mean, we've, rather than incorporate prophecy and tongues and interpretation of tongues in a service, we've just eliminated it and said we don't want to mess with it.
Yeah, we've been teaching in our church, when you're in a service and it just occurs to you that the Lord wants to do something. You just feel like the Lord wants to do something, but you don't have a clue of what it is. You don't know what it is. Give a tongue, an unknown tongue. Why? It's unknown to you. what the Lord wants to do, but it's not unknown to him. And if you give an unknown tongue, the interpreter will initiate what you were sensing that the Lord wanted to do. You didn't know what it was. If you did, you could have prophesied. But God will give it to the interpreter, and then this way, the Holy Ghost has injected himself right into the middle of the service, simply with that little sense of knowing in any one of a number of people in attendance.
Yeah.
They just knew God wanted to do something.
Well, here's the thing with that. I mean, if you will be faithful to speak out what you're getting in your spirit in a tongue that you do not understand, you open up the door for the Holy Spirit to be able to speak to you or through somebody else in words that you do understand.
Amen.
And it's all by faith.
Amen.
Absolutely. I'd like to comment too, Gary. Just thinking about it, as you start saying about the interpreters, if we don't allow the Holy Spirit to speak in tongues and interpretation, we are missing God moving in that service, either for everyone there or for one particular. And the point is, when my husband was saved over 40 years ago, and we didn't know anything about tongues and interpretation, but we were at a prayer meeting that they knew what to do.
And that's a powerful testimony.
Yes, and yeah. I'm just going to say 1 minute about it. The lady spoke in tongues, and at that time my husband said within himself, "Well, God, if you're here like they all think you are, why don't you show me?" Well, the elder who was the interpreter at the front of the room, we all had our eyes closed. It was a meditation time. And the interpreter said, "I am here tonight. Why don't you believe in me?" But what my husband saw saying that was Jesus.
He had his eyes closed.
He had his eyes closed.
And had a vision of Jesus.
Yes, was saying, "I am here tonight" through that interpreter.
Yeah.
So that's how powerful God wants to move.
Amen.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
So we need to do more in this day and age, rather than trying to make everything just perfect in the service. Just allow the Holy Ghost to do what he wants.
Yeah, we need to be willing to follow the agenda of the Holy Spirit, not our agenda.
Right.
So I was telling you about this the other day, a few weeks ago. I gave an offering or an invitation for people to receive the Holy Spirit, and a lady came up and a man came up. And as I get ready to lead them in a prayer, I always explain a little bit about Acts chapter 2. And then I also include that, you know, people that I've seen baptized in the Holy Ghost, some of them get their prayer language like a little baby. Mm-hmm. Mama, Dada, just a couple words. Others come out with the Gettysburg Address in tongues. And I no sooner said that, and this woman bursts out in the Gettysburg Address in tongues. And I hadn't prayed. I almost kind of felt left out, you know, because I hadn't prayed for her, hadn't laid my hot little hands on her hot little head. And but she received the Holy Spirit. She just stepped out and received it.
Praise God.
And then the gentleman that was standing next to her, she grabs his coat sleeve and starts giving a message in tongues. She knows nothing about the gifts of the Spirit, but she starts giving a message in tongues to this fella, and I had the interpretation, so I gave it. And then once that was done, then she ended up giving a message in tongues again and interpreted it herself. So if we will step out of the way and allow the Holy Spirit to flow rather than doing our agenda, we're going to see a lot more of the Holy Spirit moving and meeting the needs of the people in spectacular ways.
You actually see that in the book of Acts, where not only did they speak in tongues, but they prophesied and gave thanks and praised the Lord. Go ahead, Rob.
What went on in our church when we first started this, when you first came and preached on it, pastor started encouraging everyone to practice at home. And it says in there that I can pray in the Spirit, but yet I can pray in with my understanding. And he would tell everybody, just pray in the Spirit for 15 minutes and believe God for the interpretation. So this is something you just don't come to church and just blurt it out. But you can practice this at home. And it's for your everyday use anyway. And sure enough, praying in tongues 15 minutes, and I said, God, I'm going to believe you for the interpretation. And it was fantastic. It was awesome. It came out with such flow and rhythm and rhyme. And you can do this in your own private time to get ready for church. Mm-hmm. And then bring to church what God deposited on the inside of you for that time that's open.
I don't know if I'm going to say this exactly right. I'll just trust God that it'll come out right. But as you step out in faith to say those words that you don't understand, you're in a way, God's developing faith in you.
Mm-hmm. Yep. You have to have faith speak something you don't understand.
Right. And as God develops faith in you to step out in faith towards Him, He's the rewarder of them that diligently seek Him.
Yeah.
He's going to reward the faith that you step out in. Mm-hmm. And, you know, they call it a word of wisdom, a word of knowledge. Why is that? Because He gives you one word. But if you'll be faithful to step out and say that word, He'll give you another word and another word and another word. Yep. And pretty soon you'll have a whole message, mm-hmm. whether it be word of knowledge or word of wisdom or prophecy. Or the interpretation of tongues. But we have to step out in faith.
One thing we understand with this gift of tongues is we are literally giving voice to the Holy Spirit. We're talking about making room for the Holy Spirit. Now, part of making room for Him is preparing for Him to come. And like you were sharing, Rob, you're praying in tongues at home. And practicing this, and the more you practice it, the more you give your voice to the Holy Spirit, the more apt He's going to show up in our services. And let me say something about that. You know, these operate by faith. The gift of tongues operates by faith. What do I mean? Well, we believe that when we speak out in this language that our head doesn't understand, the Bible tells us that we're speaking mysteries in the Spirit. Howbeit, in the Spirit He speaketh mysteries. He tells us that in chapter 14 of 1 Corinthians. So we just simply step out by faith and do that, giving voice to the Holy Spirit. Now, we do that privately. We do that in our devotional life. We can do it in church, in worship. It's a great tool and aid to worship. But as we've said in the past, I'll say it again, this gift of tongues, encompassing the public gift and the private gift, it's the same in operation, but different purpose. So how do we operate privately? We just get on our knees, say, Lord, I'm going to pray in tongues, and I believe that what I'm saying is going to be edifying, it's going to be a blessing, it's going to build up my spirit man. He that prayeth an unknown tongue, the Bible says, edifieth himself. We believe, according to Scripture, that when we don't know what to pray as we ought, the Spirit prays through us. He that searcheth the hearts knoweth what's the mind of the Spirit, and he makes intercession for the saints according to the will of God. That's Romans 8, 26 and 27. So by faith, we understand this devotional gift has many benefits. But in the same way, by faith, we expect when we speak out in tongues in a church service that even though it's the same operation, we're still operating by faith. Mm-hmm. And now we've got a little structure because the Bible tells us in 1 Corinthians 14 that it ought to be expressed in the church and it ought to be expressed in a specific way with two or three individuals speaking and one interpreter. So when that order's in place, we step out in faith, open our mouths by faith. We're not necessarily, I mean, unctions can come, anointing can come. You can break out in a cold sweat. You can hyperventilate. I mean, you can do all kinds of things in the flesh that you feel. But fundamentally, basically, you just have to step up and open your mouth and let God speak. Anyone want to...
Yeah. When there's a tongue given in a church service, it places a demand on everybody's faith that's in the room. They have to, they can't just be neutral. They either got to believe or they don't believe. And of course, in our circles where we teach properly, at that point, everybody believes. Well, you know, God's going to say something here. And that raises the faith of everybody in the room, which raises the anointing. The power of God that's in the air goes up a notch.
Yeah.
When a tongue is given. If the tongue is not given, it does not. But yeah. The faith doesn't go up in a room. And the power of God in the atmosphere doesn't go up.
Yeah. And yeah, go ahead, Mark. Yeah.
Well, that, what you were saying is very important. Everybody's got to be on the same page.
Yeah.
You know, because if they're not, you can be speaking forth the tongue in faith. You can be speaking forth the interpretation of faith or word of wisdom, word of knowledge, or so forth. But if it's not being received in faith, you know, that takes an act of faith on the people in the congregation to be able to receive that by faith.
Plus, it gets the attention of everybody in the room.
Mm-hmm.
You know, quite frankly, when you're having worship, everybody's not engaged necessarily. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? But if a tongue is given, you can't escape that.
Immediately, everybody's ears perk up
on that one thing.
Yeah.
You know, and are you going to believe it? You know, yeah. And now you're listening for the interpretation. So, I mean, it draws the faith up of everybody.
Yeah.
And it sets the stage, the platform, the foundation for the Holy Ghost to begin to move and do things.
Absolutely.
Otherwise, we trap ourselves into what's on the bulletin or something. You know what I mean? We get in our pigeonhole and don't have any way of getting out of it.
Yeah.
But that takes you out.
Yeah.
Now you don't know what the interpretation's going to be. So right here, we're making a turn that we weren't expecting, and God's about to give it to us, whatever that is.
Yeah. And I want to reiterate, I'm going to read these two scriptures that I had started out to read from chapter 14. But, you know, why do we take time to worship in a church service? Because as we read the scripture, we see that ought to be incorporated in a church service. You can look at the book of Psalms. You can look through the New Testament. Worship is a big part of it. Paul told Timothy concerning the word. He said, preach the word. And so we preach when we get together. But there's a very plain and clear scripture in chapter 14 that tells us simply that tongues and interpretation ought to be a part of a church service. And that's found in verse 26. And he says, how is it then, brethren, when you come together? Now keep in mind, he's already talked for 25 verses on the gift of tongues, interpretation of tongues, and prophecy. And he says, when you come together, every one of you hath a psalm, hath a doctrine, hath a tongue, hath a revelation, hath an interpretation, let all things be done unto edifying. Now that's an important part of the verse there as well. Let's not just pick and choose what we're going to have. Mm-hmm. Let's let all things be done unto edifying. Now, we include other things in a church service. We have announcements, we have testimonies, we receive an offering. But of all the things we do in church, we ought to, at the bare minimum, we ought to include these five things in a church service. And what would that be? It would be singing and worship, preaching and teaching, a doctrine, a tongue, a revelation, an interpretation. Revelation is sandwiched in between tongues and interpretation because revelation comes as we give ourselves to tongues and interpretation. And I'll go on here to verse 27, and he gives us the order of how this ought to operate. If any man speak in an unknown tongue, this is a broad spectrum, means anybody in the church, basically anyone filled with the Holy Spirit, let it be by two, or at the most by three, and that by course, and let one interpret, let one qualified, let one equipped, let one gifted, one person set apart and designated to interpret. Praise the Lord. Right. Praise God. Does anyone have anything to add to that? Praise the Lord, how you've operated.
Threw me off.
Yeah. Praise the Lord.
I like how you taught Gary when you came to our church about teaching the people, and as you do, Pastor Gary Rutter, that there are those that feel led to bring forth a tongue, and the pastor is the interpreter. And so they feel at ease that, Lord, do I have to bring the interpretation to? They might feel uneasy about it. And so then they'll step out to, when they feel the unction of the Holy Ghost, put up their hand saying, I have a tongue. And then, as you were saying, Pastor Gary, that then you say to them, hold it for a few minutes because you're finishing a thought of your sermon. And I think that's all decent and in order, and it helps develop the congregation. And then once, as they continue to develop and bring forth the tongue, then at some point they'll feel comfortable many times to bring forth the interpretation. And that's just developing the body of Christ and doing everything in decency and in order. And that's how, why aren't more churches like that?
To
let the Holy Ghost move in decency and in order.
God gives you the mechanism to develop your faith. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things unseen.
Yeah.
So how exactly do you exercise your faith if there's not something unseen that you're expecting? You know, if you didn't come in sick, you don't need to be healed. If there's not... How do I place faith's demand on something when there's nothing demanded?
Yeah.
We could go down to this pond over here and walk on the water, but we don't have a scriptural foundation for that.
Right.
But we do have a scriptural foundation for tongues and interpretation.
Absolutely.
And it puts a demand on your faith. And thereby you build yourself up in faith when you operate by faith in these gifts. And they do develop, just like Marlene said. You begin to believe, and you begin to take hold. You begin to see how God reveals things to you when you begin moving in faith.
Well, I would say this, and like maybe you pastors, or even Rob, you could comment on this. We want to make room for the Holy Spirit, but I think sometimes people are concerned or afraid. Well, if we let the Holy Spirit move, we don't know what He's going to do.
Praise the Lord.
Through
wildfire.
I mean, you know, we've got it to where we got the deacon controlled and the song leader controlled, so they're not doing anything silly. But if we let the Holy Spirit out of the box, what is He going to do?
We might just have church.
We might just have church. But that is a concern to pastors. If we just let people, you know, flow in the Holy Ghost and speak what, you know, willy-nilly, what come what may, what's going to be said and what's going to happen. So what happens is a lot of pastors shy away from making room or giving time for the Holy Spirit to speak. But I'll tell you what fixes the whole thing is verse 26 and 27. Just have some order in the church. We limit it to three people. And we have one interpreter. It's next to impossible to make a mistake given a tongue. But anyway, maybe you can comment on that. We don't have to be afraid to let the Holy Spirit have way if we have some work.
Go ahead.
Sure. Okay. And I've said this before, and I knew it. The time that I made the mistake in giving a tongue is when I did not give the tongue.
There you go.
It was missed.
Yeah.
And it went by, the interpretation went by, the faith went by, and the service didn't rise like Pastor says.
So, I would like to say this, Gary. The serpent said to Eve, "We shall be as gods." And we still want to run the service like we're God.
Yeah.
And He's not.
Yeah. Rather than giving Him space. I liked what you said, Rob. Most of the time we miss it, not in speaking, but in not speaking.
In not speaking.
Yep. My wife has said the same thing, you know, several times she's come to me after a service, you know, I felt led like I was supposed to do something. I said, well, I guess, you know, we missed our chance. You know, you can't go back and redo it. Most of where we miss it is in not speaking or not giving the Holy Spirit room. Go ahead, Mark.
Yeah. Well, an additional thought. There's a phrase that there is no such thing as a stupid question except the one you don't ask. And there's no such thing as a wrong tongue except the one you don't give. But it's amazing how we pray for and we sing, crying out for the glory of God to fall, and then when he tries to, we run away and we want to take control back. We need to get out of the way. We need to let the Holy Spirit run freely under these controls. You know, God's a very, very organized being.
Amen.
And you know, it's not when you come under things with God, it's not chaos, but it is orderly.
Remember what Brother Hagin said, it's better to have a little wildfire than no fire at all.
Yeah. That's right.
So let's, you know, in Smith Wigglesworth, he said, if the Spirit of God wasn't moved, I move the Spirit. If it wasn't moving, he said, I move the Spirit.
He started
stepping out in faith.
Your faith places a demand. And that's what God is looking for. He's not offended with it. He delights in it. He'll run to the one who has the audacity to believe.
It says it's over in Chronicles that the eyes of the Lord are going to and fro throughout the whole earth, mm-hmm. just looking for somebody that he can show himself strong on
Amen.
Behalf.
Amen.
Whose heart is perfect or mature towards him, or sold out 110%. And if you're sold out 110% to God, you're going to step out and speak out in tongues. And God is just looking for somebody like that.
Amen.
Most of the time we err on the side of not acting or yeah. not moving,
like Rome,
as opposed to letting him move. I received a nice testimony from a gentleman at a church here this weekend. I'd preached there 2 or 3 years ago. And, you know, when I come into a church as a visiting minister, I try to make room for the Holy Spirit, let him interrupt me anytime he wants to, but most of the time I'm ministering, I'll preach a message and then I'll have the people worship and praise, you know, kind of set the stage, set the atmosphere, and just tell Jesus you love him and worship him a few moments. And as we do, you know, I don't know, it something happens where I can get sensitive and start moving and flowing, but sometimes, even when I don't take time aside, he just interrupts my message. And right in the middle of a message I was speaking, he had reminded me of this, and I've done this on numerous occasions, but I began to prophesy during my message, and I said, God is going to increase this church in money tenfold, and in people tenfold. And I made that statement, then I walked in front of an individual, pointed to this gentleman and said, and it's gonna start with you. And
he was busy.
Huh?
Just kidding,
yeah.
Just kidding.
Yeah, so he just felt afterwards, you know, gosh, that was God speaking to him. He felt like that. From my standpoint,
yeah.
I kind of wish I had just kept my mouth shut, you know, because
yeah.
now you've committed yourself. Well, if the church don't grow and the finances don't come in, then what's going to happen? But
I can tell you what's going to happen.
Yeah, I said it starts with you. And so I never, you know, I just walk away from the church and go about my business and trust that I'm hearing from God.
Can I say something?
Yeah, go ahead.
What would happen. If you didn't do that, it wouldn't happen.
It wouldn't.
When you came to our church back in 1994,
probably
it was.
Yeah.
You know, we had a 3 or 4 day revival or something, and my son was just maybe 12 years old at the time. And you were closing up the meeting, and you said, "Does anybody have anything that they want from God?" Because you prayed for the sick and all that, and we were closing up. my son sticks his hand up, and I'm thinking, well, what does he want, you know? And so you called him out, and he said, we need a house, a new house. You know, where did this boy come from? And you remember what you said?
When do you want it?
You said, you'll have a new house in 30 days. I thought, come on, you know, okay, whatever, you know. Well,
wow.
We had looked at a house that people owned, and because they felt that the Lord told them that a pastor would buy their house. And we just flat out told them there's no way we could buy. It's a nice house, we really like it, but it just isn't going to happen. We don't have that kind of money.
Yeah.
And then this meeting came along, right? They called us back. Do you want to rent to own? I said, well, we were in that house in 30 days, just wow. like you said. Yeah. What would have happened if you hadn't said that?
Mm-hmm. Well, this really...
Just even given the invitation, is there anything anybody wants?
Yeah.
And then your son spoke up.
Yeah.
But we begin to see the dynamics of prophecy and the prophetic, well, in conjunction with the gift of faith that
right.
was in operation.
Well, nobody's faith would have rose to that if the prophet hadn't said it.
Yeah, yeah.
Who would bother engaging something like that?
So you have two aspects to a prophecy. On the one hand, we're literally speaking something into existence. You know, there's creative power in words. And the other aspect of it is we're speaking forth the mind and purpose of God in prophecy. So you have these two come hand in hand. The one works with the other. Yeah, God's plan is to prosper and bless. God's plan is to do such and such. But he always uses an individual to come and speak it out and make it plain.
God is sovereign. And he has sovereignly decided that he'll move through men who believe.
Yeah.
And the Lord's will is not always accomplished because men don't always believe.
Yeah.
We pray every day, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. But nobody could read the news or watch the television and say that God's will is being done. There's so much that could be happening if we rose in a place of faith to accomplish God's will.
And begin to speak these things out.
You know, well, I better.
Well, it's over in Ephesians 4. The whole purpose of the ministry gifts is to raise and train the body of Christ so that the end result is that we all speak the truth in love. Mm-hmm. Well, what is the truth? We're faced with facts, mm-hmm. the facts of life, and we're faced with truth. Pilate asked Jesus, what is truth? And very simply, Jesus in John 1 said Jesus was full of grace and truth. He said in John 14:6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. And in John 17:17, he said, Father, sanctify them through thy word. Thy word is truth. So we're confronted with facts, the facts of this world, the facts of life in this world, and we have an opportunity to choose what we're going to step out in faith in. Are we going to exercise our faith towards the facts or the truth, which is God's word?
Yeah.
Amen.
And we don't deny facts.
No.
Facts are real.
No.
But we believe the truth.
Well,
that's right.
I've used this before. It's like icing a cake. Mm-hmm. You know, you have a red velvet cake mm-hmm. with buttercream icing. Mm-hmm. And it's a two-layer cake, and you've got it all set, and you take a dollop of icing and put on top of the cake, and you spread it around a bit. Now, is that cake iced? No. You keep adding and adding and adding and smearing around, or you know, until all you see is icing. You don't see any more cake. Then it is iced. Mm-hmm. Well, the cake is the facts of life that we encounter, and the truth is the word, and the icing is the truth. we keep applying the truth to the, as icing to the cake, and keep doing it until all you see is the Word of God.
Yeah.
You don't see the facts contradicting the truth. And actually, that's, I think at that point in time, when you step out and proclaim, that's when it happens.
And there's certainly different levels of faith that people operate in, and you know, we're working in, and faith is a product of relationship. It's a product of fellowship with God. You know, when I say, you know, well, you'll have your house in 30 days, you better be pretty close to God if you're going to say something like that, or it may never happen, because you can just say a lot of things and they'll never come to pass. But this, getting back to this fella in New York, I looked at him, I said, it's going to start with you. And we had gone preach a couple of places. We were in Albany, New York, and we were preached at a men's gathering Saturday night. Then Sunday morning, we went to a place called Freehold, New York. Anyway, we came back and we were visiting. We were about to leave and come back home, but this man grabbed me. He said, you don't know what happened a couple of years ago. You were here. And he said, you called me out and said, well, you said the church was going to grow and the finances were going to increase. And then I said, I pointed at him, he says, it's going to start with you. Well, he didn't think anything of it. He just felt like it was the Lord speaking to him through me. But he told me about a week later, maybe 2 weeks, they came to him and said, you're not losing your job. You're going to have the same job. But the, I don't know, something to do with the state, how they did their income, but we're going to have to double your income. And so,
problem.
Whatever he was making, they absolutely doubled it. So we're not talking a $5 or $6 an hour raise. We're talking they came in and doubled his income. I thought to myself later, I thought, well, if he'd have just taken that half, he could have at that point taken half his income and supported the church. I'm not saying he did that. His tithe increased for sure. You know, God, one move of the Holy Ghost can turn things around and make it different for you. And this is directed towards these out here. I'm going to have a tongue. One of you two fellows can give the interpretation, whichever you choose. Baha shikina moropo repe shikito romo. Braha teki shekobro nene nikipo. Brada dono jeleketita pashta.
And you thought to watch today to inquire and learn some things, but the word of the Lord has come specifically for you. Amen. Take it, embrace it, and run with it, because he's gone a long way to get it to you.
Kipoho cheni bropo hoho. Wa nipet to soma genikitito. Bropo kranta sheke plantesti.
And as you take what you're learning this day, the Lord will fill you and fill your church with his unction and his glory. And you will begin to see the fruit of the Spirit blooming and blossoming and flourishing in your church.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. I tell you, I can't go back. I can't go back to the way I did it before. Mm-hmm. How about you, Marlene?
Right.
Amen.
And what came to me as you were giving that forth, Gary, and to that same man, you would say, what is that for me? Yes, it's for you. Take it by faith. God has your path outlined for success, for victory. So walk in it. Because he's right there with you, and he will do what he said he will do.
Wow. Amen. That's powerful. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Listen, when we do these things, people think, you know, oh, it's just, we're not playing games. This is God's business. This is God's work. It changes lives. And like I said, I can't go back to a 20-minute sermon and three hymns and a poem. if we're going to have church, let's get the Holy Ghost involved. Let's get him in the midst of it.
There's an interesting aspect of the definition of the word worship. Now, Sundays we have a worship service. Mm-hmm. Okay? Well, worship, yes, we honor God and we, you know, reverently, respectfully honor him for who he is. But there's another aspect of the word worship that means this, to become like. So when we get together on Sundays, we're getting together to become like God. Mm-hmm. To see our characters and our personalities molded and shaped to reflect mm-hmm. the integrity of his character and the faithfulness of his personality. Mm-hmm. You know, every day of our lives, everywhere our feet take us.
Mm. Amen. And you know, in that sense, we're his voice in the earth. We're his hands in the earth. We're his feet on the earth. And we're allowing him. Think about this. We're talking about giving room, making room for the Holy Spirit in a church service. But hey, let's just make room for him in our daily life.
Deuteronomy says, you know, I've called heaven and earth to record. Now, the word record in the Hebrew just does not mean to write down, but it means to duplicate. Mm. So God has commanded his creation of heaven and his creation of earth to duplicate against us our choice for that day. So I've called them to record this day against you. Well, what day is today? Mm. June 14th. What time is it? 7:30 in the evening. He's called heaven and earth to duplicate our choice today, June 14th at 7:30 in the evening, what our choice is going to be, because he set before us life and death, blessing and cursing. Mm. He gives us the answer and says, psst, hey, choose life. Yeah. So that your seed, you and your seed may live and be able to love me by obeying my voice. How do we show God we love him? By obeying his voice.
Amen.
Sure.
Okay. But we're here. Let's go back to Genesis 1:26. He created us in his likeness and image. We're to be his representatives here on this earth. Going back to what you were saying.
Yeah.
Today, June 14th, or whatever day you see this, you know, whatever hour, whatever second of that day, we're there to represent God.
Amen.
And if we represent him, we're going to experience life and blessing rather than death and the curse.
Yeah. Amen. Okay. Amen. It's given place to the Lord. We want to give him place in our personal lives. We want to give him place in the church service. And what's he want to do? I think it's very interesting in chapter 14 when Paul talks about a church service, he's talking about tongues. God speaking to us and through us. He's talking about prophecy. God speaking to us and through us again. He's talking about interpretation of tongues. God speaking. God wants to make himself known in our midst. He wants to tell the church what he wants to accomplish and tell us what he wants to accomplish. I have a friend. I was talking on evangelism some this weekend, and I have a friend. She's 85, somewhere in there, but just a soul winner extraordinaire. You know, she'll walk into a doctor's office. This happened a month ago or so, and she'll see a young lady there, and she says, "Oh, what are you doing this weekend?" She says, "Well, nothing." She says, "I'm going to church." "Did you go to church last weekend?" She says, "No." "Are you a Christian?" "No." "Would you like to be? Jesus has shed his blood for your sin and he's forgiven you and you can become a Christian." She accepted the Lord right there in the doctor's office. She had a time, one of my favorite stories of hers is she's at the cheese counter in a grocery store. You know how cheeses, I mean, there's 30 different kinds of cheeses, you know. And she's looking at the cheese and she says, "So many decisions." And she looks at the man next to her, and he says, "Yeah, a lot of choices." She looks at him and says, "Have you ever made the decision to receive Jesus as Lord of your life?" He started weeping in the grocery store and gave his heart to the Lord. If we can learn to be sensitive, we can minister to people. We can share with people. We can help people. I mean, would to God someone come along and tell me that God's going to double my salary, you know, or, you know, give me a blessing or give me a house. That's a great thing if we'll obey God and be a blessing. Go ahead, Rob.
I'm just going to tell a story that happened this week on Monday. I woke up Monday morning, was praying in tongues early, like I normally do. Right after I was done praying, I believe I prophesied, but I was just praying to God. And I said, "Today, I want one person, Father, that I want to awaken that's asleep in the gospel. I want to wake him up." Sure enough, I go into this lady's house. I'm doing my work. She comes up behind me. She asks me a couple questions. You know, "Is this all you do?" "No." I says, "No, I'm a preacher too." And she says, "Oh." And we started talking about God. Here comes find out she's a Methodist and she wants to know more about what's happening in the earth. And I preached to her for about a half an hour. She rededicated her life to Christ. She's gonna go back to church. She's gonna start doing. And if I would not have been praying in tongues, I'd have never spoke that. How many angels did I release when I spoke out to prepare that lady that day?
Yeah. So what's important?